Qulb, Muddawari, O third eye, the center of perception. Many times we do not get clear perception of things around us. We remain in a state of confusion, do not know what to do and how to do about things. From the very childhood, the Hindus are told that third eye belongs to Shiva. It is known as the eye of destruction. When Shiva opens his third eye, everything burns into ashes. You did not explore beyond what was told to you. Hindus call this center as third eye center or Anjana chakra, while Sufis call it Qulb Muddawari. According to Sufis, Qulb Muddawari, Qulb Sanowari, the heart center, and Qulb Nilofari, the thousand petal center, constitute the place of Ruh or soul. Shiva is known for his third eye, which is located above the middle point of his eyebrow. This eye position is regarded as a psycho-spiritual center in human body as Anjana Chakra. It is the center of positive energy in human body. When this center is awakened, that implies the whole spiritual energy in the body is now properly flowing, and in the absence its negative effect dominate. The enlightenment of spirit is represented and centered at the position of this particular center or Qulb Muddawari. The energy awakening gives all power of clarity to the possessor. Human can see everything in this universe with this energy. There is an ancient tale about it. It is said long ago, before the creation, Shiva was once engaged in deep meditation. Sitting in the Himalayan mountain, his blue legs were crossed. Long hair fell gracefully over his broad shoulders, and his two serene eyes were closed in focused and concentrated effort. Nearby, large edifices of snow break and crumble, launching themselves down the mountainside in a very beautiful pattern. Below him, a few creatures brave enough to carve out a life in those high and desolate mountains and tussle over a scrap of food and territory, while winds howl as they twist and rustle through the trees. The winter forest landscape, however, none of these create a ripple or disturb Shiva, who was in his meditation. And not one sign of movement can be found on Shiva and in his stature. He is completely unaffected by his surroundings, so deep is the intensity of his meditation, and so strong is the serenity of the austerities he performs. Shiva's playful consort spotted Shiva during his meditation, robed in plain and flowing garb of a forest hermit. She gathered her companions around her. Giggling amongst themselves, they encroach upon the place where Shiva was seated in meditation. Trying not to break the branches underfoot or kick up the snow and wet their robes, they slowly and slowly, excitedly made their way through the pine trees and across the snow-laden mountain sides. As they broke into the clearing surrounding his consort, gestured to her loyal friends to stay behind as she moved forward. She bunched up her flowing garments in her hand and tiptoed inch by inch to the seated figure before her. Once she was about a mere centimeters away from his folded knees, with a jovial child's grin on her face, she lunged forward, cupped her hands over Shiva's serene eyes. Now this is a normal thing, we play in game. Someone comes behind you with the cupped palm covers your eye. In this Shiva's consort came from the front, using her palms cupped, covered his serene eyes. Instantly the entire globe was thrust into complete and utter darkness. Birds froze in the mid-air, cows became living statues while grazing in their lust-green fields. Tiger about to pounce on its prey was rooted to her hiding spot, while the deer was fastened to his feeding ground. All life became still and quiet. This is what happens when we have closed our eyes and perception is not clear. Everything becomes standstill. There is utter confusion. This represents a state of confusion. Suddenly the skin on Shiva's forehead, framed by Uma's finger, the consort's finger, began to radiate the heat of 1,000 suns. Pure raw energy poured from his crown as a magnificent jet of fire burst from his forehead. The unbridled strength of that flame flew out across the mountains, consuming everything in its path. The birds, as if refueled, flapped happily again. The cows resumed their content crunching, and the tiger continued her chase. When it is said it is the eye of destruction, this has to be understood. If a new structure is to be erected, the old has to give way. The old has to vanish. This is the process. You cannot have the old structure existing and new to build. First, you have to remove the existing structure, level the ground, and only then, after the debris and everything is removed, a new structure can begin. Once the flames had subsided and the mountain has been forged anew, the light began to recede from Shiva's elegant visage. Where heat and energy was once poured, a fearsome closed eye remained. This is known as third eye, and the light radiating was coming from within. Third eye is also known as inner eye. It is a mystical and esoteric concept referring to a speculative invisible eye which provides perception beyond ordinary sight, as happened in this legend. In certain spiritual traditions such as Hinduism, third eye refers to Anjana or the eyebrow center. In Theosophy, it refers to pineal gland. Pineal gland is at the back of the head, exactly at the same location where third eye center is. The function of pineal gland remains unknown. We do not know the function of this gland. The third eye refers to the gate that leads to inner realms and spaces of higher consciousness, because you are getting a totally a different kind of perception. Third eye is said to be located around the middle of the forehead, slightly above the junction of the eyebrows. In other traditions, as in Theosophy, it is believed to be connected with pineal gland, and according to this theory, human had a far ancient time an actual third eye in the back of the head with the physical and spiritual function. Over time, as humans evolved, an eye atrophied and sunk into what today is known as pineal gland. And according to research, when this gland begins to function, there is a release of a substance called DMT, dimethyltryptamine, an entheogen, which he believes possibly could be created in large quantities at the moment of birth and death. That is why it is said, when a sheikh or a master is entering into the other realm, tremendous energy is released. And if one is conscious and available to that energy, one can be enlightened that very moment. Shiva is known as destroyer as well as the restorer, is one of the most complex Hindu gods. Various symbols surrounding him detail about qualities and the energy fields. Shiva is also known as Trayambak. Trayambak means one who has three eyes. It is believed that he uses the third eye to see beyond the apparent and protect the good ones from the evil doers. All the evils and the ignorance vanishes as third eye opens. In Buddhism, this eye refers to the eye of consciousness, which asks the followers to see the world beyond the physical eyes. It advises seekers to see the world with their mind. In certain Eastern and the Western traditions, it is known as the gate that leads the seeker within to inner realms and spaces of higher consciousness. When we look at Taoism and the Chinese religious sects such as Chan, which is the name given to the Buddhism when it evolved in China and it merged with existing Taoist system, and when this system traveled to Japan, it came to be known as Zen. The third eye training, they give a third eye training which involves focusing attention on the point between eyebrows with the eyes closed. And while the body is in various qigong positions, qigong is the word that refers to movement of energy according to the Chinese system of Taoism. The goal of this training is to allow the students to tune into the correct vibration of the universe and gain a solid foundation on which to reach more advanced meditation levels. Taoism teaches that the third eye, also known as mind's eye, is situated between the two physical eyes and expands up to the middle of the forehead when opened. Taoism claims that third eye is one of the main energy centers in the body, located at the sixth center, forms a part of main meridian, the line separating left and right hemisphere of the body. In Taoist chemical tradition, the third eye is the frontal part of the upper dantian and is given the evocative name Muddy Palate. The meridians, in according to Taoism, are known as upper dantian. Christian mystics also spoke of this. Father Richard Rohr said the concept of the third eye is a metaphor for non-dualistic thinking. Human beings are divided into two aspects of the mind, either this way or that, but they do not follow the middle path. What is the middle? Buddha emphasized and introduced the term middle path. You look at the tightrope walker. He walks on a tightrope. He has a long wooden pole in his hand. He leans to the left and to the right, and thus he continues to maintain his equilibrium to remain in the middle. According to the Christian mystic Father Richard Rohr, third eye is a metaphor for non-dualistic thinking, the way the mystic sees. In his concept, the mystic employ the first eye, sensory input such as sight, the second eye, the eye of reason or meditation, that is the left and the right eye. One refers to sensory input such as sight, the second eye refers to eye of reason, meditation and reflection, but they knew not to confuse knowledge with depth or mere correct information with the transformation of consciousness itself. The mystical gaze built upon the first two eyes and yet goes further. He refers to this as having the mind of Christ. You have come in the center. This continues, but there are effects. There are effects that are seen when this particular center is invoked. The third eye emits flames and burns things to ashes. It is believed that when the Lord is extremely angry, he opens his third eye and punishes the culprit. Many people assume that because of his destructive third eye, Lord Shiva is known as the destroyer. There is something deeper than that. The right and the left eye represents his activities in the physical world, as happens with each one of us. If we take that symbolism. The left and the right eye represent the activities in the physical world, while the third eye symbolizes his spiritual wisdom or power. When it invokes, you get another perception that you can look into the unknown and unknowable world. There is yet another story associated with the origin of the third eye of Lord Shiva, and it is quite interesting. It is said, let us look at it, why Lord Shiva developed the third eye. It is said that after the death of his wife Sati, in her father's yajna, the story goes on that Sati's father had a religious function in which he did not invite Shiva. But his wife Sati decided to go to her father's place against the wishes of her husband. She goes there, and there she found that her husband was being insulted. She destroys, everything gets destroyed, and she sacrifices herself. When Shiva came to know about this, he was deeply grieved by her death. So he withdrew himself to a cave and went into deep meditation. It is the time that Sati was reborn as Parvati, which is another name, and set out to marry Lord Shiva once. But in spite of all the efforts, no one could break the meditative stance of Shiva. Then God sent the God of love to break the meditation of Shiva. The God of love sent an arrow that hit Lord Shiva, and he opened the third eye, and that burned the God of love to ashes. Significance of the third eye, and thus represents the rejection. So what happened, that the God of love represents the human desires. When the desire reaches a meditative state, it is rejected and it burns it into ashes. It represents the rejection of the desire. It killed the God of love, and thus the desires. So Shiva represents a state that rejects the desires, because he understands that when the object of desire goes away, there is immense sorrow and rage arises, which develops in a being. Hence, to stay away from the desire is the best way to attain to bliss. Still, there are many legends associated with it. Sometimes it is good to know the different legends, but my main point is to explain the deeper aspect of it. As such, you live in a dimension of the known and dwell amidst the objects and beings. There are dimensions beyond the known, and my emphasis is to explore the dimensions beyond the known, give you a new perspective to life and living, indeed a deeper perspective. These dimensions that are beyond the known cannot be explained logically. It is not physical. Therefore, third eye is the center of perception. Its perception is beyond the known. When energy reaches a certain peak within you, you get a new clarity. A new vision into life and living comes. you see everything with a different vision and new perception. This is known as inner eye. Your vision is turned inward. Normal eyes open into the outer world. You cannot roll your eyeballs inward to look within. You need a different kind of perception, different kind of instrument. Third eye has the capability to look within and without simultaneously. It can do the two things, look within and without as well. Now you can see life beyond the normal limitations. Perception has risen beyond the known, the physical aspect. Why is third eye connected to a particular spot in the body? It refers to sixth sense very often. And you go on using this word sixth sense without even understanding. In yogic terminology, it is known as Anjana Chakra or the third eye center, or in Sufi terminology as Qulb Muddawari. This center is slightly above the spot where two eyebrows meet. There are three dimensions attached to it: inner vision, outer vision, and movement of energy into a state of emptiness that leads to meditation. Inner vision, outer vision, and movement of the energy into a state of emptiness. These are named after three forms of Shiva. These are actually experiences that point that energy reaches these points, the vision alters. When your existential energy remains at the earth center, which is the first center, and it remains stuck, it does not move from there, you completely remain in that state, and it operates from that center. The man is only interested in food and sleep. Very often you will find the people who are only interested in eating and sleeping. This represents that the energy is stuck at the physical center or the Muladhar or the earth center, and it does not move from there. This is a way to analyze our own a state of inner development. When energy reaches the next or the second center, or known as water center or Swadhisthan, and you operate from that center, because man operates through an energy, and energy remains at a particular place, so that becomes your place, center of operation. When you operate through the second center or the water center, you seek worldly pleasures alone. Nothing else matters to you. Worldly pleasures, eating, drinking, and all that relates to the worldly pleasure. The life is totally of worldly in nature. Then when it reaches the third center, which is the solar plexus, or known as Manipur, means the center of fire, the dominant energy makes the possessor of that energy, and operating from the center makes him a doer or achiever. When energy reaches to that center, you are a doer. You can achieve anything that you set your mind onto. But this should not be the resting point. None of these centers should be the resting point. It is like I have given you this story of a Sufi mystic sitting under the tree, and a woodcutter was passing every day in front of him to go to the woods to collect some wood to make his living. One day the mystic told him, "Why don't you go a little deeper into the forest there is a copper mine. He reached there and he found it was a copper mine. First he was doubtful. If this mystic knows about the copper mine, why is he not going? But he went and he found the copper mine. He started exploring copper and his life changed. Then one day the Sufi told him about the silver mine, the gold mine, the diamond mine, so on and so forth. These are the attractions along the way. Then one day finally when he started exploring the diamonds and he was very happy, his life was of prosperity, then one day the mystic again appeared. So the poor woodcutter said, what could else be beyond the diamonds? The mystic said, haven't you realized that I knew about all these? I knew about the copper mine, about the silver mine, about the gold mine and the diamond mine, yet still I am not attracted to any of these. What else could be beyond the diamonds? The worldly man cannot think beyond the worldly achievements, that there could be something beyond all this. So mystic said, I know there is something beyond the diamond as well, and that is why I am not going into. When you reach the Manipur center, you are very much excited that now I can achieve anything. I am a doer. I can achieve anything. You are stuck at that center. At Manipur center or the solar plexus, the dominant energy makes its possessor a doer, an achiever. With energy now, if it continues to move further, it reaches the heart center, and operating from this center, which is Qulb, energy manifests as creativity in myriad forms and dimensions. So when someone becomes creative, and energy begins to manifest in many forms, once again there is a possibility of remaining stuck to it. You have become creative in any field, be it music, be it art, be it culture, be it in any other field. You started getting kudos about it. People started appreciating. You are continuing to make your living. Appreciations pouring in myriad forms. You get stuck to it. You make it a permanent resting point. You do not move forward. The energy gets stuck. And you are stuck at the level of the silver mine. But there is other mines beyond that also. You have to always remember that story, that there are mines after the mines, deeper in the woods. Your attention, your focus should not be on any particular mind. These states or the movements through the psycho-spiritual centers are like the mines of different precious metals. At the heart center, one becomes, when heart center is invoked, one becomes creative. Creative instincts manifest through a person. And creativity manifests in myriad forms. One can remain stuck or enjoy the creativity for a short while and continue the inward journey to reach the ultimate. When the same existential bioenergy reaches the third eye or the Anjana Chakra or the Qulb Muddawari, it turns inward. Instead of operating into the outer world of objects and beings, it gives a seeker a new clarity. You are elated that you have gotten the capability to look into the deeper aspect, to go within. You look at life in a new perspective. Life cannot disturb or distract you now. Also, it cannot take toll on you. What else can be better than that? So as up to now the life was taking toll on you, now you have reached to the point that life cannot take toll on you, it cannot disturb or distract you. At this stage, the experience is only intellectual. It has not become existential. At Qulb Muddawari, the experience is intellectual only. Intellectually, you know the inner state of bliss. You know that you are getting a clear perception. Life cannot take toll on you. You have a clarity of your path and ways and means, everything. But it has not become existential. Although stability is there, but you do not know what ecstasy is. And that comes only when you go beyond this and you reach to the next center, Qulb. Nilofari. One can journey from the base center, the earth center, to the third eye center. There are myriad ways to reach to the center, that is from the first to sixth. All paths in the world, the yoga, the Tao, Zen, Buddhism, Sufism, all these paths of Zikr, Jazb, Suluk, can take you only from the base center to the third eye center. Beyond this, there is no path. That is why it is known as pathless path. You can reach up to the state of fana, but from fana to baka, there is no path. You can reach to the center. However, the journey beyond the third eye is pathless. That's why it is said, Sufi said, you have to abandon logic first, then abandon the desire for the other world. We enter into the spiritual path to sanctify our ukva, the other world. This is a desire that has to be abandoned. And then third, you have to abandon the master, because master becomes an obstruction. He keeps you tied from your journey. This is very important. And Zen emphasizes on abandoning the master. This is a game. The master-disciple is a game, played according to the script. Each one of you are accustomed watching the movies. In the movies, a script is written. There are different characters. A man acts a character in which he has to rape the heroine, who is responsible for this rape. Is the character responsible for it? Or the person who plays that character? Imagine, Mr. X portrays the role of a person according to his script and performs a rape. Who is responsible for this act? Mr. X, or the character that he is playing? It is in relation to the script. This refers to the subtlety of action, subtlety of karma, which is very deep. This I will take at another time. So the journey from the third eye Qulb Muddawari to Qulb Nilufari is pathless. There is no path. It is like a quantum leap. Just as there is a lit flame and there is an unlit flame, no one knows when the lit flame transfers its light to the unlit one and makes it lit. From Anjana or the Qulb Muddawari to Qulb Nilufari, the thousand petal center, there is no set path to follow. At this stage, the seeker has to abandon all that is known. From here the journey into the unknown begins, and it is all alone. You are all alone. Your consciousness is with you. You have to abandon everything. Weightless, you can climb the glacier, the mountain. The heavy weight you have, you cannot reach there. Naked, you have to go there. The journey is a quantum leap into the unknown. You can jump into the unknown if you are either crazy or you trust somebody's words totally. Even if you think for a moment, you cannot jump into the unknown. You do not care what will happen. One thing is certain, whatever will happen will be good. Only two types of people can jump into the unknown. Either you are crazy, you do not know what you are putting into, your wife, your spouse, your all that is known keeps on telling you, what are you doing? Why are you entering into the unknown? Do you know what will happen after that? If you are courageous, no, I am going to jump into the unknown. I am sure whatever happened will happen. This is craziness. And also there is another reason that you trust the words of someone so much that you do not think for a moment. And sometimes your spouse says, you're just listening to that person. Don't you have your own mind? Can't you think for yourself? Can't you think about your children, your wife, your husband, your surroundings and everything, what will happen to them afterwards? No. This is a state where you do not care for anything except that which is. Whereas at the third eye center, you get total clarity into life and how things are. You know how life progresses. You do not live the normal daily life, daily routine life. Instead, you live a life as an entity, as existence. With clarity of vision, you conduct your life differently. And most of the time, people cannot understand this, and you remain an enigma for them. When energy reaches the crown center, and you operate through that center, the Qulb Nilufari, you are so ecstatic for no reason. You may be poor or rich, nothing disturbs your bliss or inner state. You are ecstatic because you are. At the third eye center, your journey of enlightenment begins. And when energy reaches the crown center, you are in a state beyond enlightenment. And when you have reached to that state, really the journey now begins. The journey up to now, it was all preparation. I have heard about Rabindranath Tagore, the poet. He has written more than 6,000 songs, and each one of his songs refers his offered to the unknown. He was at the deathbed. Tears begin to trickle down through his eyes. The intimate people who were in his inner circle they were surrounding him. They said, "Kavindra, why are you sad? You have written more than 6,000 songs and stories, and each one the reference to the deeper aspect of life, and you have tears in your eyes." He said, "All these songs, all these years, I have been trying to set to tune the orchestra. Before you begin to play, before an orchestra begins to play or give its performance, each instrument has to be attuned, tuned in properly. When all the instruments are tuned into oneness, then the performance begins. In the same way, human body has many instruments, and each begins to play its own tune, and the orchestra is out of tune. And that is how the human life is out of tuning. All this that I have done so far is to tune in the orchestra. The orchestra is tuned, and now when time is for me to play the ultimate music, it is time for me to leave. That's why I am sad." This is the state of an awakened one. He considers his life as a preparation to tune the inner instruments so that one day he can play the inner music, and music will begin to flow. That is music of the beyond, music of the unknown.